Hello, welcome again. You know why we're here.
That's right. We're gonna have a war, but it's gonna be civil a little bit, and we're gonna debate about a topic.
Gonna be slightly civil.
That's the yeah.
That's their name. Like five different focus groups to get that name, and that's the best we could come up with.
Yeah, we did it.
Anyway, this week's debate is VR the future of gaming. I, Yahtzee Croshaw, will be arguing for this state of affairs.
And I, Jack Packard, will say emphatically that VR is not the future of gaming.
Okay, this should be fun.
Yes, and Yahtzee, I'd like to introduce a new character to the show.
Oh, blimey.
Yeah, it's me, but it's me with all the facts. It's Fact Jack.
Fact Jack?
Yes, I'm not bringing any opinions into this debate. I'm bringing only cold, hard facts. You want to cite my sources? They're in the description. Check out those links.
Well, this might be interesting because I've just got a whole load of blue sky dreamy points.
There you go. That's all you need to know. I win.
Well, let's go through the formalities of actually saying our points.
Oh, sure.
Right. Is VR the future of gaming? Well, I don't see how you could argue that it isn't. Science fiction writers have agreed on this fact even before VR was a real life thing. It is an inevitable endpoint in the ongoing development of games as a simulation of life. From the moment the first game was created where someone could press a button to make a thing move around on a screen, that has been moving towards a more and more realistic depiction of movement and reflex until the inevitable endpoint of that is a full immersion into what appears to be a real-life simulation, and that's what VR is.
More immersion, you say. Well, that leads directly into my point, which is how can something so uncomfortable be immersive at all? Yahtzee, I want you to look at fashion from our human history. Look at the fashion from the Victorian era. The incredible complexity of the outfits, the belts, the ties, the fasteners in lace. Now, look at our modern day sensibilities. We're wearing t-shirts and pants. And, you know, now with everyone in quarantine, the pants are optional.
Okay, I'm wondering how you're going to get this back to VR.
Throughout the generations, we've been placing a priority on comfort. Now with VR, game designers are asking us to strap some sort of medieval torture device to our heads so that what? We can play pretend better? I think not.
Well, it's hardly a medieval torture device. It's a little pile of plastic and wiring that you put on your face. And while some early headsets had difficulty with comfort, this is all stuff that is being worked out in the ongoing evolution of the technology. VR headsets are more comfortable now, a lot more comfortable than they were 5 years ago, and presumably by that metric will be 5 years worth even more comfortable 5 years from now.
And I'm sure if I put a pillow in between the brick and my head, the brick will be more comfortable, but at the end of the day, I still have a brick on my head.
Is this about the weight of the VR headset? Because the weight is another thing that will be reduced as technology inevitably improves, miniaturizes, becomes cheaper and more accessible to developers with lower income. I don't think VR is particularly more heavy than, say, an interesting hat at the moment. If it was a particularly interesting hat, say worn for some kind of cosplay event, it's about that level of discomfort.
My only rebuttal to that is to say, look around. How many interesting hats do you see on people nowadays? None.
Well, I don't know where you're hanging out. But I think we're getting away from the main thrust of the debate, which is that VR is the future of gaming. Your current argument is against VR as it currently stands, as a heavy and unwieldy device. I'm saying that it is inevitable that it will improve, and it will inevitably become the main way people game.
I will go on to my second argument now, and this one, this is going to be a big loop, so I'm asking you to stay with me here.
All right, I'm bracing myself as we speak. I am tightening my sphincter and ready to go on this ride with you.
So while it's true that VR offers more immersion, that immersion comes with a bigger ask. It asks the player to physically move their body. Sometimes it's just your arms, but sometimes the game developers ask you to move your entire body to be fully immersed in the game.
What you're arguing there is a subset of VR games, though. There are plenty of games, particularly games I enjoy, that are happy with just sitting down. And you get just as much of the immersive experience just from the act of looking around with your head and moving around with your fingers.
But then you are limiting the experience, the immersive experience, unless, of course, you are playing as a character who's also holding a controller.
Isn't that basically any first-person shooter or any game where you pilot a vehicle?
If you're arguing that VR will be the future of gaming because all games will be piloting vehicles, then I guess I have to concede. But until then, I say that current VR games have you having one-to-one movement with your character. Picking up items, squeezing things to throw them, using your Beat Sabers to sync up and hit boxes. And I say that consumers will reject this because it's asking them to move. Let's look at some numbers here, Yahtzee.
Oh, must we?
We must indeed. You know that the CDC, the Center for Disease Control, reports that the average weight for an American adult has risen 30 pounds in the last 40 years. And you know, our average height has only risen by 1 inch, resulting in about 40% of our population being considered obese. And then if you look at a study by the prestigious Mayo Clinic looking at the rise in unhealthy weight gain, it found that its participants' non-sleep consisted of 58% sedentary behavior. Now, the Mayo Clinic attributes this to a few things, like a change in our work environment, but mostly to the rise in screen time, specifically video game screen time. And I know this isn't a debate about how much larger we've become as a population, but I use these facts to support the notion that we as consumers choose not to get up and move around. And therefore, any device asking us to do so will never gain the player base needed.
Ha 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 ha. But you have sown the seeds of your own argument in the straw man you just made of me right there.
No, I am not the farmer of your discontent.
Yes, you are, and I was feeling very straw man-y back there. But now, behold, as those seeds of your downfall sprout. Because you're saying, with your carefully researched facts, that Americans are becoming more obese, yes?
As a result of sedentary lifestyle, yes.
And as Americans become more obese, Americans being obese becomes more of a mainstream problem with society. And as it becomes more of a problem with society, society will inevitably look for more solutions to that problem. One of which could be full motion tracking video games with which people can get their daily exercise and have plenty of immersive fun while they're doing so. And in that course of events, VR is all the more inevitably the future of gaming.
I have a collection of dusty Wiimotes that would disagree with you.
Are you fat?
Probably. No, I think I'm about average weight.
No, you are not fat. Therefore, you do not need to exercise, and therefore my point still stands. And as you say, video games in VR are a fundamentally more immersive experience. And as I say, science fiction for many years has shown VR becoming a real life thing, as in what will soon become known as the prophetic documentary Ready Player One. But I think it's misleading to think of VR as a full motion activity, as you're presenting it, even though the full motion would be good for exercise, as I was saying. A lot of VR, as I say, is played perfectly well on the couch, and you only need a certain amount to get you to a certain level of immersion. I agree that a game asking you to excessively exercise breaks immersion. I mean, in a game like Gears of War, you're sprinting from cover to cover all the long day, and most people just can't keep up. But it's enough just to be able to feel like you're holding a gun and look around and see the thing that's to the left of you just by moving your head. That is enough to create the immersive experience. Once you've tried it, it is hard to go back.
Well, then I suppose that would be your problem. Getting consumers to try it, whether or not we're talking about my uncomfortable argument or the fact that VR is so cost prohibitive. You can't ask consumers to try something if trying it means that the hardware itself can cost up to $1,000, and then you have to buy the games, and then you need a computer beefy enough to run these things.
Pish, pish, posh, pish, push, push, posh. The Oculus Quest is just one example of a VR headset that doesn't require a computer, but that's besides the point. My point being that, again, you bring up VR in its current state as an argument against it being the future of gaming. It wasn't that long ago when the microwave was considered a piece of exotic, expensive technology. Now, every household has it. You probably get a free one if you move into an apartment block.
Yes, and I say to you that a new gimmick is still a gimmick. If you look at older gimmicks like 3D gaming, motion controls, or the Xbox Kinect, these things were exalted as the new form of gaming, the future of gaming, all of which have fell to either carnival tricks or dustbins.
It's true, they were exalted. They were exalted before the technology had been fully worked out. They needed to exalt them to try to crowbar them into a state of mainstream popularity, but it never worked because it was never enough. VR, on the other hand, is enough, and it doesn't need to be exalted. It speaks for itself. You try VR and you go, oh bloody hell, this is a fundamentally more immersive system of gaming, and I am bloody sold. That's what I bloody am.
I think that you are confusing your relative luxury with something that most people cannot obtain.
Again, the financial issue. Again, technology over time becomes cheaper. My final point that I'd like to bring across is that VR, as an experience, requires total immersion. It means you have to cover your eyes and cover your ears to the world around you. And therefore, one could argue that its increased popularity is an inevitable result of the real world becoming worse. And I don't think anyone could argue that the real world has been down quite a few shitters lately. And that being the case, VR's increased popularity has been inevitable, and its growing popularity will continue to be inevitable.
It's honestly hard to argue against that.
Well, I win then. Hooray! Feel free to play Sound of Audience Applauding now.
Well, if you liked this good-hearted debate, you'll like even more our casual conversation. Go see the show that comes after Slightly Civil War, which is the podcast of Yahtzee and I talking about the subject as if we were expressing our real thoughts and ideas. It's available now on iTunes and Spotify. There should be a link, but I'm not in charge of the links, so I don't know.
We assume there will be a link. And perhaps you could also listen to it as well as see it. You'd probably get a better time.
Did I say see it?
Yeah, you said see it.
Ha ha! See it with your ears, sucker!